All right, friends, welcome to the Dalplex here on the campus of Dalhousie University, AUS Women's Basketball featuring your Dalhousie Tigers. Today the Tigers are hosting the two-time defending champion, Cape Breton Capers. The champs come in here still in first place this year, tied with UNB and Mont. The Tigers in unfamiliar territory. The Tigers rebuilding this year in seventh place. My name is Bill McLean. I'm joined by Emma Cooper. And Coop, our question right away answered. There is Carrie Everett returning this Capers team. She was out first term. She'll be a huge player for this Capers team.
Yeah, and like we were talking before the game, Bill, Carrie Everett was someone that, as a team, you'd get prepped for her. You'd have a defensive play sort of ready to deal with her specifically, and then you get out on the court and she'd still always be in double digits. So pretty tough player, pretty tenacious, and she's bringing a lot of experience to the Capers.
So even without Carrie Everett, the Capers still managed to go in a three-way tie in first place. So heads up now to the AUS. They have Everett back, and now will be very dangerous. Of course, it's a Capers team, though, that's not as dominant as they've been. They've won four of the last eight national championships, but it's a team that is shooting below 40%, below 30% from the three. They've struggled here and there, but the thing with the Capers that are really going to give the Tigers fits, and you remember from your playing days, back when the Tigers and the Capers were a big-time rivalry, they just get after you in the full court.
Yep, and they're just a really good digging team. They'll dig down, and they'll make it happen, and they'll rally back if there's a deficit, and they sort of really band together and make it happen. And they're just really tough players as a whole.
Well, it should be a tough matchup here for these, again, a Tigers team that has been gutted by graduation over the last couple of years. 2 years ago, they lost their entire backcourt. Last year, they lost their entire frontcourt. So it's a Tigers team that is on the mend from all those outstanding players that you played with for a couple of years. And the youthful, and a team that has struggled with the pressure anyway. So buckle up, Tigers fans. This could be some tough early moments here. Interesting to see when Fabian, the coach of the Capers, starts to go with that full court pressure.
Yeah, for sure. And I don't know, traditionally, I think as the Tigers, we've struggled sometimes with dealing with full court pressure. But we did see the Tigers play really great late in the last term against St. Mary's. And there was that was a really high energy game from both teams, and Tigers narrowly losing in the sort of final seconds of that game. So Tigers can definitely jump in and surprise a team here. And if Cape Breton takes anything for granted, I think that the Tigers have some really great players who will be able to step up and capitalize on it. So
the Tigers do come in having suffered a couple big losses, 68-38 to X and 97-49 to UNB, and a huge loss by the Tigers team that has shown some glimpses of improving. And a big addition tonight, Rachel Harrison, kind of the lockdown guard, and can shoot the three back to help out that backcourt.
Rachel's not suited up, though.
Well, I thought I saw Rachel in the pregame running around. Maybe she went to therapy for another. I could have sworn I saw Rachel running around. Hopefully Rachel is back. Do you see her in the civvies?
No, Rachel does not look. She's not suited up. She's sitting on the bench there.
Shoot. Maybe I got her mixed up with another player. Well, then that could be extra tough now for this Tigers team. We thought we had Rachel Harrison coming back. And right away, there's her first look at the big kid. Toxopius from Kanata, Ontario. Fourth-year senior, averages 10 points per game for this Capers team. And there is, right away, a little bit of pressure here by the Capers. They'll come with that double right around midcourt. And a Tigers team that already is turning the ball over about 22 times per game. So this could be hard times. There's the player right there, Coop, that has emerged for the Tigers. Four seconds left here on the shot clock. There's Cordy Thompson driving the lane to Garatowski. Gets it off, and that is good for Garatowski. Right on cue, Tia Garatowski averaging 11 points and 6 rebounds now. Of course, the thing with Tia is foul trouble.
Yep. But Tigers, nice little steal there. Tigers are doing good. If they can just keep running and keep in their own game and not let the Capers control the tempo of the game and make it really up-paced, then they're going to have a better chance in this basketball game.
There's the fourth-year senior, Nicole Works, and there's that play. The Capers run to death. That's their leading scorer, Kernan, who comes up short on that shot. But that, I remember, maybe you remember from coaching or the days with Dr. Savoy, and I remember trying to coach the Huskies team there as an assistant. That Tigers, or that Capers play where they run that foul line entry and then the back door, you diagram it, you practice it, you defend it. But come game time, they just seem to always get it. Seems to drive you crazy.
And they've just got enough, they've got enough girls on their team who can aggressively take it to the hoop and who can make those inside elbow jumpers that they manage to execute well on that kind of play.
Well, there is Nicole Works. Takes it to the hoop and gets a foul here on the youngster. Trisha McNeil, of course, the Tigers team, first and second year players abound on this Tigers team. I think the senior player out there right now is Garakowski, the transfer from Grand Prairie, Alberta. But it is a Tigers team that is kind of building towards next year.
Yep. And again, with all the newer players getting tons of experience this year, hopefully they'll gel as a team, and you'll see some really amazing things. And we're definitely seeing lots of glimmers of that, for moments. So it's really just extending the really solid play and keeping it going longer and longer and bringing in that consistency every game.
With that said, I should mention Brooke Sullivan, number 10 out there. Hello to the Sullivan, Zemir Machie, Anna Von Malsen getting started here. 2 points for Anna. Brooke Sullivan has kind of become the anchor of that team, the fourth-year senior.
Yep, she just makes really good decisions when she's out on the floor, and she's very consistent overall. And Tigers are playing pretty level-headed so far, so hopefully they can keep that up for the rest of this ballgame.
Well, there is Brooke Sullivan, inside-outside player, Brooke Sullivan. Her sister Brittany also plays here for the Tigers, if it's your first time watching us. There's Trish McNeil, the local product from Halifax, along with her longtime partner there, Anna Von Malsen. She's also played with Trish in high school. Rebounded by the Capers. Scrappy play there by Kayla McCurran from Sydney.
That was a good hustle by Von Malsen, but we want to see people hold on to the ball a little bit longer, pass it around, and again, not let the Capers set their tempo for the game.
There's McCurran. A little up fake, but got a little ahead of herself and a travel on that CBU far side. So, Jalika Kernan from Toronto, the fourth-year senior out there, averages 13 points a game, out there with Works and Everett. Starting lineup here for the Capers, along with Toxopius. And up there it is McCurran. Garatowski, she's all hustle and energy.
Yep.
But again, she needs to stay out of foul trouble.
Yep, for sure. And the perimeter players are able to help her out by that, by, again, getting the ball out to the wing and making sure that they just have a really easy pass into the post player, because it can get really hairy if you're trying to throw the ball in from the top of the key.
Fresh shot clock here for the Tigers. 7 minutes left in the first quarter and a 4-4 tie here in the early going. So the Tigers have, a lot of times when you play the Capers, you got to withstand that initial charge they bring.
Yeah, and there'll be a few of those throughout the game. But, if they can just keep playing solid, they're going to stay in it.
There's a player who was very impressive first term, Courtney Thompson, a youngster from St. John. Hello out there to the Thompsons in beautiful St. John. A lot of energy Courtney Thompson brings.
Yeah, she really does bring a level of dynamicism to the team. It's good.
Well, there's our first look at Jalika Kernan. She has not shot a high percentage this season, but gets that one to go down. And a 7-6 lead now for the Capers. And the Capers now content to start out in half court. But if you're over there on the Tigers bench, at some point it's going to come.
Yep.
That Capers pressure.
Yeah, and part of what the Capers bring is, too. There's a little bit of an edginess when you play them. You're like, what are they going to pull? What are they going to pull? So, again, Tigers have to stick to their own game, not think about that, and just keep focusing on doing the simple things well and getting their mechanics down.
Von Malsen. Brooke Sullivan, high-low with Garatowski. And Garatowski has shown that she gets a little too fired up down there. She kind of needs to calm down as the game goes on.
Yeah, it can be difficult when you're consistently battling it out down there in the post, but that was a lovely pass into her.
So a missed chance there. Backdoor play, and there's Toxopius. Rims out, actually, for her. And an offensive or a rebounding foul here on Toxopius, so double frustration on her.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. Dalhousie's really holding their own against this team so far. So, if anyone underestimates Dalhousie, then they're going to be able to take easy points off them. And everyone's really close in this conference. So Dal just has to keep doing what they've been doing so far this game.
There's your first turnover. And a lane opens up for Kernan. And 5 points now for Jalika Kernan. And there is Thompson. Again, against that Capers pressure, Everett out there. The fifth-year senior now, Carrie Everett, hard to believe her career is now in its last term. Garatowski, nice little drive, comes up heavy, and rebounded by the Capers with McCurran.
Yeah. You can't underestimate what having a committed fifth-year does for a team because they want to win in their last year. They're not messing around at all, so it definitely brings a level of focus to the practice.
Nice-looking stroke there from Kernan, but comes up short, and now the Tigers on the break. A turnover well played there by Kernan. Crossover dribble on Sullivan. Now the Tigers a little tired getting back. And that leads to a chance for Nicole Works, and she makes no mistake.
Thompson was taking all those layups against the game against Smu. She was just taking it all the way and going for it. And a lot of times you see in women's basketball, they're trying to pass off rather than taking it. Would have been great to just see her take it all the way in that instance.
Well, Trish McNeil up top with Thompson again. High low for Garatowski, surrounded by a couple Capers. And 3 seconds in the lane on Tia. And hello out there to you, Garatowski's in DeBolt, Alberta.
Now we're in the game for CBU Capers number 5. Tanier McCarthy.
Capers seem to be doing a pretty good job of helping out and putting a little bit of pressure on Garatowski. So they've got to be able to see her get the ball in, and she needs to be able to kick it back out, and we'll make something happen on the perimeter.
So Tanira McClurkin in here from Baltimore for the Capers. Of course, the Capers with that Baltimore pipeline for both the men's and women's teams. And Brittany Sullivan getting her first action out there now with Brooke. Down there for Toxopius, working on Brooke. Nice play here for the Capers, but waved off. What was that, Coop?
I didn't see.
Traveling on the play. Dave McGrath,
number
official.
CBU number 32.
We'll see if the Sullivan sisters can take the turnover and convert it into some points here for Dal.
Brittany with her first touch of the game. The left-hander up here. Hands off to her sister, Brooke. Now Brittany. Left-handed three-point shot. Nothing but the bottom for Brittany.
Gotta like that. It's wonderful. It's great. Showing great experience to be able to come off the bench and just drain a three like that right at the start of the game.
So maybe the Sullivans drew that up in the bedroom last night before they went to bed.
Yeah.
The twin sisters getting together on that. You hand off to me, you pass back to me, and I'll shoot the three.
Just designing their own plays, for sure.
And how about there, the Sullivans and Miramichi? Friends, remember your email is tigerswebcast@gmail.com. tigerswebcast@gmail.com. I'd love to hear from you, Capers and Tigers fans. And there is Carrie Everett, what she does so well. Off the backboard with the drive. We talked about it before the game. And you practice for it, but she just always seems to be able to get to the basket.
Well, and in that situation, the post player looked ready to pop out and get the ball. So either way, it was going to be a tough situation for Dal.
Tigers ball, 16 on the shot.
Well, it's doubleheader tonight. Tonight here at the Dalplex. Coming up, it's number one versus number two. The number one Capers. Coming in here with all that swagger to play the number two Tigers in men's basketball. So stick around for that. But before that, we've got these plucky rebuilding Tigers with the two-time defending champion now, Cape Breton Capers.
Yeah. It's just not quite the spark that we've seen in other games in this game. It seems like both teams are a little bit slow getting going. So it's interesting to see who steps it up.
Trish McNeil wild into the lane there. Heavy off the front rim. And now coming this way, it is McClurkin, a little spark plug, and that went too far over there for Lucienne Leahy. First look at Leahy, the fourth-year senior. And here's a kid who you got to think is going to be huge coming down the stretch. Stephanie Hiltz, she's shown an incredible ability to hit big shots, especially in that St. Mary's game.
Yep, and she seems to thrive under pressure, and she does really well for Dalhousie under pressure. And they definitely, I mean, that's exactly what you needed against a sort of experienced and cohesive team like Cape Breton. So it's great to see her getting some minutes.
And look at Trish McNeil pull up for three. So the Halifax native Tigers break the press, and McNeil with an early three here. 13-12 now with 3 minutes left in your first quarter for the Capers. Down here, our first look at Denisa Haywood. She's also from Baltimore.
Seeing a little bit of the Tiger press that they've had some success with in the first term. So that was an easy turnover. Let's see if it keeps working for them.
Hiltz matched up there with McClurkin. McClurkin takes it right away from Hiltz, and now she's got teammates. Nicole Works takes it herself for two. Nicole, and there's your Capers pressure. And 15-12 now is the lead, so now the Tigers have got to be careful here.
And we're starting to see Cape Breton sort of chip away at Dal like that. Little things like that can get into people's heads, so Dal's just got to regroup and keep moving on.
Von Malson, that little baseline shot she loves, but comes up front rim. Tigers have got to make them pay here when they beat the pressure, too. And now the Capers haven't noticed that the scoreboard isn't changed. It should be 15-12. 13-12 up there right now is still the score on the board. Von Malton, a little shot there for Brooke Sullivan. She'll hit that all day long. So Brooke.
You got to love a post player who can take that shot, step out from the elbow like that. It makes you really, really versatile. If people come out to guard you, you're going to drive on them, and if not, you're going to sink the shot.
Capers working around out over there. That is Leahy. And turned over on that little handoff play with Carrie Everett. And there we go. There's 15-14 now is the score. So the Tigers hanging tough here in the opening quarter. There's McNeil.
They can support each other in the backcourt and just get the ball down quickly. and have a more success in this basketball game for sure.
Nice cut through the lane by McNeil, and that one just rims out by Trish, but a nice ball cut there.
Yeah, she got robbed there.
And now the Capers looking frazzled here.
Some uncharacteristic turnovers here, and their turnovers seem really unforced. They're not necessarily as a result of incredible defensive pressure coming from the Tigers by any means.
Well, the Capers unloading the bench here early on. This is Kira Peterson. And now for the Capers. Hiltz with McNeil. Nice little cut there by Sullivan. Von Maltzen working over there on McCarron. Brooks Sullivan up top here working with the big kid Haywood. Takes her off the dribble. And it's going to be a foul on the floor here on Haywood.
And we haven't seen an overly physical game this game so far, and it's sort of the refs can really set the tone with more physical teams like the Capers. The refs definitely can play and have an impact in the tone of the game and how much physicality you're able to get away with.
Trish McNeil comes up short on that one. So not a lot of fouls here so far. Two team fouls on Cape Breton and one on the Tigers. Down here for Haywood. She's a low down there for Sullivan. A little off fake. Brooks got her trapped and kicked out to Nicole Works. McCarron over the top of Von Maltzen, comes up way heavy.
Nice rebounding there by Brittany Sullivan there.
Ripped away by Brittany. And now with Peterson giving her some full court pressure. 15-14 as we approach our final 45 seconds. 10 seconds on the shot clock. Trish McNeil gets a foul here, and she will go to the line. That's on Nicole Works.
And Trish is doing a great job of consistently driving, consistently taking shots. It's great to see she's getting the foul there. But she does a great job for this team, consistently taking the lead, never being shy. And, you know, it's just great experience considering she's sort of often that's what you expect from a fifth-year player.
So that foul, the first on Nicole Works, three team fouls on the Tigers, and 15-15 now is your score. Trish McNeil going for her fifth point. That one comes up heavy, so 4 points now for Trish. And they got a ball to the Tigers here, so the Tigers with a chance to really...
Returning for the Tigers, number five, Courtney
put up some
Thompson.
Points. Yep. Courtney Thompson back in the game now.
Again, not an overly energetic game, but we're seeing little glimmers of that. Brooke Sullivan was doing a great job on the defensive end. If you look at her check, she's 4 inches shorter than her check, and she wasn't, you know, she's not letting her score, and she's doing a good job down low. So, lots of energy from her.
Sullivan with that left-handed drive gets cut off by Haywood. Now Thompson, that one a little too hot there for Sullivan. I don't think Brooke thought that one was coming her way.
No, that was unexpected for sure.
So an ugly possession for the Tigers and a wasted opportunity. And now a full shot clock for the Capers. 30 seconds left in the game, or in the quarter, sorry.
It does seem like both teams are just kind of working off the cobwebs a little, or like the sleepy turkey state induced by the holidays, unless you're a vegetarian. So we'll see if the intensity picks up in the next quarter, and we're almost running out of time here.
Well, 15-15 is the score, and 16 seconds on the shot clock for Cape Breton. That is Kiernan. She's the scorer, and that one comes up heavy. Rebounded by Hiltz, and now... Shot clock turned off and 15 seconds left in the quarter for the Tigers. Thompson spinning in the lane and one for Courtney Thompson. So a nice looking play there by Thompson, and now the Tigers can get a 3-point lead here.
Again, it looked like she wasn't thinking about that one, and she just went for it. And she's a quick and dynamic player, and you know, she should definitely be stepping up and trying to drive as much as possible against these teams and trying getting folks in foul trouble on Cape Breton's side.
And again, the Tigers cannot complete the three-point play. But a two-point lead here. 7 seconds for the Capers to work with. Up top here it is, Kiernan. She's going to drive by Hiltz. Gets cut off there by Sullivan. A little baseline jumper comes up short. And so a bit of a tough go there for Kiernan. But hey, break up the Tigers. 17-15 is the score for the Tigers at the end of the first quarter. Trish McNeil has 4 points. Courtney Thompson has 4 points here to lead the Tigers. So Garrett Towski, very active and nearly going. We talked about in our prelog that, you know, Tigers were going to be in trouble here, but not a bad opening quarter for the Dallas.
No, they're definitely stepping up. And little things, too, like making their foul shots and that kind of stuff is even, you know, going to help them out more. And against a good team, you just want to be doing the little things. It's not like you have to pull out a special fancy play or do anything really differently. You just have to be able to stick with your game under more pressure. So the Tigers can keep doing that and maybe hit some more foul shots in the continuing quarters. They're definitely in this.
Well, TigersWebcast@gmail.com is your email, TigersWebcast@gmail.com. Back from your playing days with the Tigers, you know, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, You guys, you had some pretty heated battles with the Capers 3 or 4 years ago, the Seahawks, of course, were in the picture as well, but you guys used to have some historic battles with the Cape. In the week leading up to Cape Breton, what was Coach Savoy always emphasizing the most when you guys got ready for Fabian McKenzie's Capers?
There would be a real defensive focus just because they had so many key people that would really be able to just capitalize. And so, again, people like Harry Everett, you would be talking about what hand they always drive with, what their tendencies are, and if we can stop their first major scoring thing and make them go into their second or third alternative, then, you know, the game plan was always, let's make their weakest team score. If a great team beats you because their sixth or seventh player scores 20 points, then they're a great team, but you don't want to let their top obvious scorers run away with a bunch of points. So that was a general focus for us usually.
Well, the Tigers, Tia Garatowski back out there again now with Stephanie Hiltz, Thompson, Sullivan, and Sullivan for the Tigers. So Tigers will try to build on a two-point advantage here. They have the ball right in front of your camera. It is Brittany Sullivan. And 14 fouls so far on the Capers and just one on the Tigers as we reset that for the second quarter. But, usually a lot of times when you play the Capers, even though they play that full-court physical style, they don't get a lot of fouls called on them.
Yep.
But so far earlier, the Tigers winning the foul war.
Yep.
Stephanie Hiltz loves that shot, but comes up short. They set up that with her. She nailed that against St. Mary's, a huge basket in a game the Tigers would go on to lose. But
yeah, but it was pretty energizing for sure.
Yeah.
It was intense.
Friends, if you didn't see that game on Haligonia.ca, the Tigers and Huskies, it was one of the highlights of the first term for sure. Tigers, of course, ended up losing. The big play for me coming down, you were at the game too, was when Justin Cauley drove to the basket. The Tigers just didn't collapse on it like I thought they should have, and they kind of gave it a lane. And I think you've got to stop the other team's best player.
Yep.
You know, and you can't, they ended up letting Justine Cauley beat them, and I think you got to make somebody else beat you.
Yeah, so, for sure. And it's obviously hard when there's someone who has got a couple tricks up their sleeve like Justine does. She's a pretty dynamic player. You definitely have to be able to make people resort on their other weaker players.
Well, that's the first person on Tia Garatowski, and one of two for Cape Breton from the line, and now 17-16 in the opening stages of the second quarter for the Tigers. And we got a foul on the Capers, so uncharted territory here from what I've seen of the Capers over the years. Some really foul trouble.
Dal's got to get excited and get fired up about this. I mean, they're, you know, being in seventh and competing really well against the first team, they've got to use this. And, it's, you know, sometimes the Capers can come out really strong. So if you're in the game, you've got to definitely capitalize it and get energized.
Courtney Thompson up top tried that high-low with Garatowski, but no luck. And now 8 seconds on the shot clock. That was a second foul, by the way, on McClurkin. And now Stephanie Hiltz comes up heavy and cleared by Carey Everett. Here comes the fifth-year senior right down the lane, over the top of Garatowski. And that one rolls in for Carey Everett, and they do not want to let her get going here.
Yep. Garatowski stepped up, and with a worse player, it would be really hard to shoot over, but Everett's got enough experience, and she made it look pretty easy.
So the Tigers now, with their first deficit here in a while, trailing by one. Stephanie Hiltz right down the lane, and off the backboard for Hiltz, the local product who transferred from St. Francis Xavier.
That was like a two-handed basket shot there. That was crazy. I like it.
Hiltz can light it up off the bench. Kiernan. Little foul line jump shot and a very nice-looking shot there for Kiernan. Smooth stroke for Kiernan. And now back and forth they go at 19-20.
Again, you don't want to see a back-and-forth game. It's a hard game for either team to be in. You want to definitely, as Dalhousie wants to be, stopping, and then working on getting their 2 points when they can.
That's CBU basketball returning for the Tigers.
Well, that is off Garatowski, and here come Vaughn Malton and McNeil to replace the Sullivans. So youthful now out here are these Tigers with Garatowski down there anchoring the paint. They got to have... Be interesting to see if Fabian begins to apply the pressure here with this youthful Tigers lineup. Nicole works. Big scramble on the floor. That was Hiltz. And talks to Pius. And
nice
possession
tackle
to the Tigers. Yep. 6 seconds on the shot clock for Dalhousie.
We have a tie possession.
Or for Cape Breton, sorry. Cape Breton.
CBU. Their basketball, 6 seconds to shoot.
So up by one and 6 seconds on the shot clock for the Capers. That is Kernan up top there with Stephanie Hiltz. Gets a screen from Everett. Three-pointer for Kernan. Heavy and rebounded and cleared by Thompson. Pushing the pace here is Courtney. Stephanie Hiltz down for Gertowski, and she comes way heavy on that shot. She's struggling here early.
Again, that was a great look from Hiltz to get it. She was wide open in the key, so you always have to make that pass if someone's that open.
Tia looks like she's got the juices flowing a little bit too much. One of the coaches might have to tell her to start to relax a bit.
Deep cleansing breath or something. Yeah. One of those. I think I needed more of those when I was playing.
Nicole works with two for the Capers, and now a three-point lead for the Capers. So Tigers have got to get a response here, and that one comes up just short from Hiltz.
Again, you love to see a younger player taking those shots. Sometimes it's better if the ball can get rotated around a couple times. Everyone gets touches, and then she can go and take that shot. You can always get a three.
There is Nicole Works coming up heavy. Carrie Everett, weak side rebound, right at the Tigers. And traveling on Carrie Everett. And the senior does not agree, but
she's not loving that call in one little bit.
And returning for CBU number 9, Kayla McCarron.
And Anna Stamberger is not going to waste any time. She's going to get her fourth-year senior, Brooke Sullivan, out there to help settle things down here. Tigers have worked hard and are dangerous territory now, trailing by three.
Yep. Again, Cape Breton is the kind of team that can get streaky and can go on a run quite easily. So you want to try and, like you said, stop it before it gets too going too far.
7 points. Well, 7 minutes, sorry, here in the quarter.
Mounts Tigers ball, 11 on the shot clock.
And 11 on the shot clock for Dalhousie.
Yeah, Dal's looking a little skittish, so they just need to settle down and make a good play here.
Nice little inbounds here for wide open Trish McNeil for three. And tied ball game, 22-22.
Awesome.
And 7 points now for Trish McNeil.
That was a nice pass at a hard angle, though, too, to see her out there, so... Dalhousie looks a little bit more fired up now, a little bit more energetic. I think they love the zone defensively, so possibly too fired up there with a little foul.
That's going to be on Thompson, careless there up top. And this is for our first friends watching the Tigers for the first time. This
Tigers
has been kind of their trademark defense, that 3-2 zone with the big athletic guard up top.
Yep. Again, we obviously don't want the foul there, but it's great to see them a little bit more dynamic, a little bit more moving, and they're definitely going to have to sort of bring that if they want to stay competitive with this team.
Now we do a 2-3 for the Tigers, and that's Carla Norad getting her first playing time of the game. And there's that baseline jump shot for Everett. Drew contact on Von Maltzen, and Von Maltzen's got to close down on that a little bit under control.
Yep. Again, Carla Norad coming into the game, defensive specialist, all hustle, and just really is a focus on the defense and brings a lot of energy. So I think that's what Dal needs right now. They can't just keep trading baskets back and forth. So hopefully we'll see Dal get a couple stops here.
How many times have your coaches told you, Emma, that you don't foul a jump shooter? And one of the easiest...
Just ringing a bell.
Yeah, Von Maltzen, of course. Cardinal mistake there, fouling Everett on that jump shot. Now Everett with two foul shots here.
But Tigers foul number four, Anna Von Maltzen.
First comes up short on the first.
Yeah, it's not a foul shooting day.
This is Everett. One of two for Carey, and 23-22 the lead for the Capers. Well, one game in the books here in the AUS Women's Basketball Play, the X-Men with a very easy victory over Carly Clark's rebuilding Panthers there in Antigonish.
So we just saw Cape Breton turn on their half-court trap, and it's sort of threw Dal off this possession. So they need to regroup and just get it under control again. So that did not look too pretty.
So right now there's a four-way tie for first place in the conference. It'll be straightened out, I'm sure, in the next couple of days. UNB is playing Mon in a huge weekend set. Those two teams are in the mix.
That'll be pretty deciding.
Yeah. There is Nick Neal. Comes up heavy on that. Rebounded down there by Brooke. And could not get that over the top of the Capers. 20 seconds on the shot clock. And that wide open look for McNeil again. And then Trish gets that one to knock down. So Trish McNeil, your early storyline for the Tigers, 10 points here.
Yeah, making some huge shots. But you got to give credit to Brooks and Sullivan for two rebounds down under, too.
25-23 for Dalhousie. 5 minutes left in your second quarter. Nice pass there. Toxopias for Everett on the baseline. A little too tough to handle. Tigers collapse. And possession arrow to the Capers.
Yeah. They seem to do a really good job of when they are in the zone of helping each other out and sort of going to the ball and getting back and going to the ball and getting back. And some teams have a real challenge with that. So So this is a good look for them right now.
Our first look at Katie McCarrigal, the local product from Halifax out there now, wearing number 10 for the Capers. And a shot clock violation, so Capers out of sorts here.
For a 24-second violation.
And
Tigers
the Tigers can go to a four-point lead here. 25-23 now for
Again,
the Tigers.
Tigers need to support each other down the court, make sure the ball gets over half safe. And once they're into their half court, they seem to be all right.
And it is turned over, that half court trap over there. Working for the Capers, and now a fresh shot clock for the Capers in transition. Dangerous pass for Carey Everett. Goes to work on NORAD. And the foul is on the floor here. So Carla NORAD with the foul on the floor. And that is the Tigers' fourth team foul of the quarter.
Again, the game is close right now, but if Kate Brennan is able to get the easy turnovers and lob it down for layups, this game could get unfortunate pretty quick for Dalhousie. So they've just got to, I'm sure they've been working on their half-court trap in practice, and I'm sure that's been a focus, so got to kind of go back to that, just settle down and be calm about it.
Half-court set here for the Capers. 9 seconds on the shot clock. It's Everett up top on the undersized Thompson. Trying to go to work on her. Nice job by Courtney Thompson in that matchup.
Yep.
And now leads the transition for the Tigers. McNeil kicks out for Courtney. And now she's working on Everett. And what an athletic play by the big girl there, Denisha Haywood.
Yeah, good hustle.
And Everett gets into the lane over the top of Thompson. Comes up heavy. And rebounded by Garrett Towski. Push pass up here for McNeil. And contact here with the Capers. That's Katie McGarrigle. So a second team foul here for the Capers. So we'll have a baseline inbounds for Dalhousie.
Dow had some success against MU when they were sort of playing the run and gun kind of game. I'm not sure if that's going to be their best strategy against Cape Breton. I can't really tell. Again, they just want to make sure that getting the ball over half safe is their top priority right now, because they've been fairly successful and they've been doing quite well in the half court, getting the ball into the post and hitting some huge. Trish McNeil's obviously been hitting some huge shots from the three, so they're not doing bad in their own end. It's just getting the ball across right now. It's got to be their focus.
Well, Trish McNeil, 10 points here in the early going. She's averaging 9 points a game so far for the Tigers, but 10 points and leading the way here for Dalhousie. Trish McNeil, a player you talked about earlier on, you know, she gets to the basket or she drives so well. First term, she kind of had a problem with, you know, that first dribble getting by her girl, but then as she got closer to the basket, she ran into some traveling problems.
Yep.
But in this game, she's shown us some three-point prowess as well.
No, she's definitely stepping up, and she looks so calm when she's shooting the threes. I mean, some people look and be a bit tentative, but she's taking big shots and making them. So, I mean, that's great. I mean, obviously, that's a huge reason why Dalhousie's still in the game. It's just she's playing a really sort of steady level, dynamic game today. So hopefully she can keep it up for the whole game.
A big game down in Wolfville today as well. The Acadia Axe women playing the St. Mary's Huskies. Those teams are in fourth and fifth place in the conference, so that's a good matchup there with Justine Colley and Emma Dunker, both averaging over 20 points per game. And of course, mentioned that UNB-Munn matchup. We can't wait for UNB. Claire Colburn of the UNB Varsity Reds, averaging 25 points per game.
Holy Diana.
UNB, 6 feet freshman out of Calgary.
Wow.
So that'll be a good matchup. And there is Courtney Thompson. Speaking of New Brunswick from St. John. And again, Courtney also, what she does so well, driving through the lane.
Yep. She's wily, that one, for sure. No, she does a wonderful job of using her quickness to get to the basket, and she can sort of dance around a few defenders and manage to find the hoop. So, again, that's really her strength in the game, as well as just she's been doing a really solid job of bringing the ball up as well. And again, Dell's in the game. They're doing great, so they just have to stick with their what's working for them so far.
Two fouls now on McGarrigle and three on the Capers in the quarter. Four team fouls for the Tigers. And with 4 minutes left, it is 26-23 for Dalhousie. And Thompson is at the line here trying to get her sixth point of the game.
And again, Dal has a bunch of people who will chip in points. And that does, for other teams, it does make it hard because you can't have one game plan. You know, if you just say, we're going to shut down Trish McNeil, then you've got Thompson or Van Malten or other folks, you know, Jaritowski, who are going to step up. So it's they are dynamic that way.
And there's that 3-2 zone with the Tigers. Von Maltzen up top. Gets down on the baseline and deflects that Carey Everett shot. Rips it away. So good hustle here by Von Maltzen.
Yeah, and she's being tough, and they're protecting the ball. Ooh.
There's that bad turnover, nasty turnover. Brooks Sullivan didn't see it coming. And a foul on Cordy Thompson. So.
Yep, that's unfortunate. Again, you just if you're having a hard time getting the ball over half, five, you want Cordy everyone Thompson, to be kind of supporting that. Sometimes their tendency is post is to just run back and get down because that's where we know we're supposed to set up. In this case, penalty. Everyone's got to be there to support and make sure as a team they get the ball over half seven, and everyone's works. Available because Cape Breton's really upping the intensity right now in defense.
Well, that's two fouls on Cordy Thompson now, so trouble there. 15 fouls on the Tigers with 4 minutes left, so the Capers will be shooting foul shots here for the next 4 minutes on any foul. And I find what the Capers do so well is you think they're going to clear out. Like you assume they're getting back on defense, and then all of a sudden they stop at half court looking to pick off the pass. So they do that really well, disguising that. They don't just clear out. They maintain that half court pressure.
Yeah, they're tricksy, those ones.
27-25 now for the Tigers. Garatowski going to work. That is a tough matchup for Tia Garatowski.
You know, and again, it was a good move, but she didn't step towards the basket. And when your defender is 6'2 with quite long arms, and that is not going anywhere.
So 12 seconds on the shot clock for the Tigers. Brooke Sullivan inbounds, gets it into Von Maltzen, handed off back to Brooke, goes baseline, runs over Everett. And Gwen, quick hands by the big Denisha Hayward.
Tiger's ball. Yeah,
her arms are getting in the way for Dalhousie right now. Again, sometimes when you're a post player, you're used to playing against people a little bit shorter, and you think you can get away with different stuff. You've got to adjust your game when you're playing against someone so tall.
Look at Hayward. That defensive possession was Denisha Hayward's. She owned the Tigers right there.
For sure.
Coming up with the block on McNeil. And now a chance for the Cape Breton Capers to draw even, and they do with Perry Everett. So, Hayward on the defensive end, Everett on the offensive end, and a tied basketball game. And a silly foul here for Kernan, and she knows it.
Dalhousie's battling hard to get the ball over and then to get points on their end, and it's sort of heartbreaking when you have a really easy bucket that goes in for Cape Breton, and you just don't step up and take someone and pick up as soon as you should defensively.
Sullivan with the inbounds, 20 seconds on the shot clock, 4 team fouls on the Capers. Brooke Sullivan going to work on Everett. Gets into the lane, kicks off for Garatowski, and she comes up short. She's had really struggled here tonight, has Tia.
Yep. I mean, it was a good kick for Brooke. It'd be great to see her go more aggressively towards the hoop, but there was a lot of traffic there.
24 seconds on the shot clock for the Tigers. 2:45 left in the quarter. And this is Cordy Thompson working on Kernan. Gets cut off there. Skip pass and a wide open three for Sullivan. Comes up heavy. Follows her shot, takes it herself, but comes up on the front rim on that layup.
You obviously want to see them convert, but it was great to see Brooke get her own rebound there. That's the kind of energy that Dell's going to have to keep bringing to stay in the game.
Baseline drive by Everett, gets cut off by Garatowski, over the top of Tia, and no lock and cleared by Von Maltzen.
Von Maltzen is definitely bringing some rebounding hustle to the game for the Tigers at the moment.
Thompson, Von Maltzen, Brooke Sullivan comes up short, Garatowski working down there with Hayward. But she's a load, is Hayward. And cleared here
2 minutes
by Denisha.
2 minutes.
2 minutes left. And 27-27. So the Tigers, good. Yeah, the Tigers can hang on here. Yeah. They've got to be pretty confident. But there's your baseline drive with Katie McGarrigle. So McGarrigle breaks three. And 29-27.
There's no one under the bucket to help out on that play and all, but.
Von Maltzen. Matched up there with McCarrigal, the Halifax native. Sullivan right at the elbow, working on Everett. Drives into the lane, and then help out by Nicole Works. Gets a hand on it. Sullivan on the floor, kicks it to Garatowski. 2 seconds on the shot clock, and Von Maltzen should have fired it.
For a 24-second violation, CBU basketball.
And a shot clock violation.
Great hustle there by Brooke Sullivan. She's doing a really good job getting on the floor and made a really great pass from the floor to her teammate. Dalhousie's doing great. They're staying in it. They're sticking with their game mostly. We don't want to see them take too many early three-pointers. That's not their game. They need to pass the ball around and sort of execute. That's where they've been getting more of their points.
So 1:14 left in the half. Nice. There's that handoff play with Kernan. Comes up short. And Everett with the offensive rebound. She comes up heavy. So Carrie Everett struggling to find her touch after coming back from injury. And now a transition attack here with the Tigers. Three Tigers, but a poor first pass by Helps. And a wasted chance again for Dalhousie.
Again, they're looking and they're seeing the open people. That Dal's actually been pretty good about finding the girl that's open. So that one didn't work out, but they'll hopefully get the next one.
ripped through here by Leahy. McCarron, sorry, kicks it out. And now confusion for the Capers, but Everett's there. Contact. Turned over. Four Tigers now. That's Hiltz out in front. And again, the Tigers waste a transition chance.
Yeah.
And Emma Stamberger, got to be frustrated over there.
Yeah, I mean, it's the sort of unforced turnovers are happening on both ends of the court. The good thing for the Tigers was that Brittany put in the effort to contest the loose ball, and then it resulted in a turnover. And you just have to keep having those sort of little effort plays compound so that you get those kind of turnovers and those opportunities.
Down low, and Denisha Haywood going to work on the offensive end now. She's been a beast on the defensive end.
Yeah.
And now a four-point lead for the Capers and turned over. And this is Nicole Works with the foul. And comes up a little bit heavy on that layup, but she'll shoot two. And, man, they just explode on you so quickly. You know, now the Capers are looking maybe at a six-point lead here as we approach the quarter.
Stephanie Hiltz. First personal foul.
And that is Tigers the Hiltz. Her first personal.
Timeout.
Again, Dalhousie's been staying in it. And as soon as you let it go a little bit, the Capers are a good enough team that they'll capitalize. So they just have to shake it off and get back to their game plan. They're scoring well in the half court. Jaritowski's been doing a great job of posting up. Considering the height difference, they've been doing a great job defensively against Cape Wren's big girls. Those girls are tall and they're all arms. So, they haven't been capitalizing on their – Cape Wren hasn't been capitalizing on their posts as much as one might expect. So Dalhousie's doing a lot of positive things. Again, if you sort of – get flustered, Cape Wren is going to capitalize on that, though.
Well, the Capers with two foul shots here, so they can improve to a 33-27 lead if they both make both, and the Tigers will have about 15 seconds to get a shot off. So I think if you're Anna Stamberger, after the foul shots, regardless of what happens, you just want to get that rebound and just play out that clock.
Yep.
You try to get a shot off, but if you're the Tigers, you got to be pretty happy right now with this deficit.
Yep, for sure. I think they are happy. But again, as a younger team that hasn't got a ton of wins under their belt this season, you've got to be hungry and you've got to want to be in this game and take the win from a good team. That's a huge motivator and that's a huge sort of ego boost that'll take them into the second part of the season. So they've got to hustle and stay in it.
Well, hello there to Pam and David Thompson watching in St. John.
CBU number 7, Nicole Works at the line shooting two.
The parents of Courtney. Of course, Courtney has 6 points here so far tonight. Two fouls, though, for Courtney. So a little bit of foul trouble for the first-year guard. And one of two for Nicole and a rebound by Carrie Everett. So this is not what the Tigers wanted. And a three-point trip for
Carrie
the Capers.
Everett.
And now 34-27 and a foul on Kernan. And that's two pressure fouls now on Kernan. So the Tigers are doing a good job of getting her to foul in that full court press.
Again, I mean, you don't want one of your best players to be the one to take that foul. Sometimes initiating fouls and initiating contact like that puts other players off their game, though. So don't think that one was intentional, but not always a bad thing to get in there and mix it up a bit and see how far the refs are going to let you take the game.
Well, there is Courtney Thompson from St. John. Now she has 8 points for Courtney, and nice job there to stem this tide. And 34-29 is the lead. So worst case scenario, the Tigers are going to go in with a 5-point deficit. And again, could be worse, could be better. But the Tigers did a pretty good job there of, seemingly growing up in front of our eyes here. Mind you, the Capers haven't really brought the pressure yet, like we know they can. But the Tigers seem pretty calm out there.
Yep. Overall, I mean, there's been a couple instances where Cape Breton has put on the pressure, and it's been a struggle in the backcourt for the Tigers. But they're definitely responding. They're definitely getting back to their game, although there's sort of moments where it looks a little hurried. But again, there's been a lot of turnovers that are unforced for the Capers, and there's been a lot of sort of mistakes on both sides. So neither team is totally playing the best basketball that we've seen from them by any means for so far this year.
Well, it's a Capers team that, they didn't have Carrie Everett first term. And weren't their usual Capers selves, but they are still, as mentioned, in a four-way tie now for first place. Even Carrie Everett tonight, back from the injury, she looks like she's still trying to find her way, playing well, but not that typical Carrie Everett way.
Yep.
And a Capers team, of course, that... outstanding five-year guard. Mm-hmm. So it's a Capers team that has some more holes than they usually have. And there's your great set play, leads to a layup chance for Kernan, rebound by Haywood, and no mistake by Haywood. So a great set play there in the full court by the Tigers, and by the Capers. And now the Capers, worst case, 7 points is the lead for the Capers over this young rebuilding group of Tigers. So probably not what Anna Stamberger wanted to see there, but a nicely drawn out play there by the Capers.
No, and they executed that to a T, and again, sort of showing their experience, and you can see when they really sort of a focused group that they can really execute. And even though it didn't go, you obviously going for the layup, they're all in there to rebound. So again, when the Capers are playing their game, they're really tough to beat. Dalhousie again hasn't caught them on their best day, and they've got to get excited at halftime, and they've got to come back and rally. And 7 points is nothing, and they can easily get in here and contend. So
if you're Anna Stamberger, you got this youthful team that you're hoping you can get to pull together to make a run towards the playoffs here, but at the same time, they've kind of got to use kid gloves at time, and they hung in there for a while with the Capers, but then kind of slipped there at the end. What approach do you take here as you go into the locker room?
Dalhousie has to be able to get excited and fired up without getting nervous. We were seeing that Tia looked a little bit nervous under the post, and that's more understandable as there's been more contact for her to deal with in this game. But Dalhousie they didn't end on a great note, but they have to get excited about playing good basketball, and they're a young team, and if they own that and say, let's not worry about making mistakes. We're the underdogs here. If people look at the scoreboard tomorrow and see that we've lost, that's maybe the expected outcome. So let's just use that and have a no pressure game where we have play like there's nothing to lose. They're playing a little bit conservatively now, and we're seeing when they do play and take risks, Trish McNeil was making big shots, and so there's glimmers of that, and they just have to run with it and say, this is huge, we're doing well. This is going to be huge for us if we win. They don't look like they're totally excited about the game that they're playing right now. It looks like they're trying to get back into it, which is fair given that it's early in the year, or the new year.
All right, well, we're going to take a break, you're going to take a break. Can you go over there and get us some stats later? Analysts, we're going to bring in a couple of Dalhousie Gazette reporters here, beginning with Natasha White.
Hello.
Natasha, you were here for the Shoveler with the men's team. Of course, the men came up short against the St. Francis Xavier Exeter. What did you think of the Tigers over the weekend with the Shoveler?
The men performed pretty good. They kind of broke it down in the final quarter against X, which is too bad. The bigs, I didn't think, performed as well as they have in the past. Joe Scow and Sandy Veit kind of had a bit of a letdown. Other than that, I mean, the AUS just has proven that it's definitely a contender in the Canadian basketball scene. So I'm expecting to see somebody from the AUS in the CIS finals.
Nice. Well, we got the champs coming in here to play the Tigers, who we think are pretty good. And then that X team really didn't have it going in the first term, but still played good basketball. And then they won the Shoveler. Today, when I left my place, they were beating UPEI 51-21 at X. So it looks like the X-Men are starting to get their swagger on as well.
They're starting to gel. And if Christian Upshaw can stay playing on the court, regardless of his extracurricular activities, whatever they may be, they are definite contenders. I mean, he's dangerous. They've got a lot of dangerous people on that team. So
right now, if you could go 1 through 3, it's Acadia is kind of that middle tier team, it looks like, and St. Mary's may continue to build, but if you could go Cape Breton, X, and the Tigers on the men's side, how do you rank those teams right now? I guess we'll know more in about a couple hours.
In a couple hours, for sure. X, well, I was at the Anna Ginnish game when Dalhousie beat X, so that was a surprise. Again, Upshaw was a healthy scratch, so that definitely makes a difference. I don't want to say it, but it's probably looking like CBU, X, then Dal.
Right.
But it's like football, any given Sunday, so you never know who's healthy, who's hot, makes a difference in the game, but they're they're excellent. And, you know, St. Mary's can beat anybody probably on any given day as well. So the AUS is an excellent conference and bringing some really good ball for the fans to watch. So.
Well, let's move on to the team of the moment, the women's team here. Not too bad. You know, I was thinking that it could be big-time trouble for the Tigers against this Capers team that likes to press you, and the Tigers have struggled in that aspect. But so far, the Tigers kind of hanging in here.
Yeah, it looks like McNeil is hot again, which is great to see. The spacing looks really good. I think Anna's worked, the coach Stamberger's worked really hard on that. You can see a difference. The girls are starting to get some chemistry, starting to work inside a lot more confidence, working at Tatia, working the ball around. Yeah, they're looking good. I was surprised. Right now they're only down by 7, and that was just due to some pretty ugly looking last 2 minutes of play from the Tigers, which is really what hurts them all the time. I don't know if how much they get beat or they beat themselves. They just have mental lapses. That final play, 6.2 seconds. You know, you can't let a fast break happen on 6.2. So if your players don't know that, you know, let them do whatever they want in the backcourt, pick them up at half, and don't let them get that 2 points. That's really discouraging for the team. They've put in such a good effort so far, but
I guess that's a trademark of a young team. They're going to have lapses, and you got to kind of fight through it. Speaking of, you know, Anna Stamberger with these kind of basket of puppies, all these young kids, what do you think she's standing there? Do you think she's pumping her or waving her fist, or do you think she's telling them good job?
I think she's really encouraged. I don't know what the score was last time, but I think it's been pretty ugly in the past.
Yep.
When we played CBU.
Yep.
Some blowouts. So to be this close at halftime, and the girls are looking good. They're working the ball around. They got some talented CBU players on the inside there. So if they can hold them off and keep pressure on their outside shot, who knows?
Her name is Natasha White. She's a writer with the Dalhousie Gazette. Natasha, outstanding stuff, as always.
Shucks, thanks.
Natasha White of the Dalhousie Gazette. And now our second Dalhousie Gazette writer, Arman Aluwalia. Fresh back from his trip overseas to India. The native of Winnipeg, my friend. How are we doing?
Good.
Good to see you. And how was the trip over there
overseas? It was good. It was long. We got the phone. But at the end, I made it there. And it was good fun, definitely.
So your thoughts here in the early going on this Tigers women's team?
Well, they looked really, really great to start. Good tempo, kept it going. But they slowly started to wear down a little bit. And I mean, like we were saying earlier in the year, it's a young team. So that kind of concerns you later on in the game. It's going to be interesting to see how they kind of stop that grinding from happening and see if they can keep up the pressure. Hopefully halftime will kind of get their heads refocused and maybe give the Cape Breton some run for their money.
Of course, after this, we got that men's game, maybe the game of the weekend or weekend set of the weekend, the two games of the Capers and the Tigers, number one at number two. How critical is this game for the Tigers going forward?
Well, I think if they want to put their place in where they're going in the AUS, I think this is a very, very crucial game. I mean, they lost a very, very close game to St. Mary's at the Tower, which was a game they should have possibly won, I think. And I mean, and if they lose another one, it might be too soon before the bleeding kind of starts to go everywhere. But I think they'll be fine. I think the game today will be interesting. CBU is a great team. They've done well, 7-0 so far. But, I mean, Dal came out pretty well in a game that they're probably not favored to win in the women's at least. But it'll be interesting. You never know. That's why they always play the game. So.
What's the key for the Tigers? You think sustaining that pressure of the Capers or...
I think
working their size advantage?
I think defense would probably be the best thing I can say right about now.
Yeah.
They've got lots of double-digit scores on the Capers right now. So
right.
Definitely making for a lot of scoring threats that could cause problematic for the Tigers. But it'll be interesting to see what kind of happens.
We get a feeling that, of course, the Tigers last year couldn't stay within double digits of the Capers or the X-Men. Had that big win against the X-Men in Eganish, but then lost in double digits to Santa Bex at the Shoveler.
Yeah,
you get a feeling that this Tigers team, even though they've improved and revamped and they have some great senior leadership, you get a feeling there's a bit of a fragile confidence there.
I feel like it's the kind of a don't bend it too far because it might break kind of deal that's going on. But, I mean, they look strong in the first few games. Hopefully they can keep it together with Julius, Simon, and the good quality talent that they have there. As long as they can get Joe Show and Simon Frain going, that's pretty much the key to the game at right about now. So.
Well, your website is www.oneinthestands.wordpress.com. And, of course, you guys do a great job covering the NFL.
Yeah.
And here we go. It's wild card weekend. You were going to stay home and watch the Saints and Seahawks?
Well, I got some loyalties here on the team, so that comes first. But, it's going to be interesting. There's a lot of, sure things, but in the NFL, nothing is sure. So, I think I'd like to and give the Seahawks no problem, but the Quest Field, it's a tough place to win. Nothing is a lock in the NFL these days, especially with the way that the season's gone. It'll be interesting. The Green Bay Philadelphia game looks like something could go either way.
Right.
A lot of people are saying Green Bay, a lot of people are saying Philadelphia with Michael Vick. Is he 100%? There's unlimited stories going on right now in the NFL, so.
Well, the marquee matchups tonight, Jets and the Colts, two teams who, with the Colts getting everybody back now, or mostly everybody back, that's a team that could go on a Super Bowl run here. And, of course, the Jets have underachieved, but they have all the key personnel. So who are you picking tonight in that Jets-Colts game?
Well, to be honest, I like the Colts. As much as I'm not a big Colts fan, I think that they've got that kind of playoff mentality now where everything is kind of striving. They're getting people back slowly. Peyton always finds a way to win somehow. It's not in the big games, but he's done well in the last few weeks. They're catching that momentum. And, people are saying that New England or Philadelphia is the most deadliest team. I think the Colts are. They're a deadliest team because you don't know what you're going to get out of them. And that could be a lot really, really scary to some teams. As long as they can get the running game going, they might be able to establish something. The Jets have a good running game with Jones and LT and Sean Green, but it'll be interesting. The key to the game is Mark Sanchez. The Jets defense will be there for sure. Peyton Manning will show up, but will Mark Sanchez be there? That will be the difference in that game, pretty much.
Well, the website is oneinthestands.wordpress.com. Armand Aluwalia writes for the Dalhousie Gazette. We'll have you back here at the halftime of the men's game.
Sounds good.
Awesome.
All right.
Armand Aluwalia, and of course you can follow him on the Twitter as well at The Real Brinian. Right there on Twitter at The Real Brinian. So outstanding stuff by Armand. We're about 3 minutes away here from the start of the second half. The score right now, 36-29 for the Dalhousie Tigers. For the Cape Breton Capers. Sorry, friends, getting ahead of myself. For the Cape Breton Capers, you are on the network ssncanada.ca. A reminder that our email is tigerswebcast@gmail.com. tigerswebcast@gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you Tigers and Capers fans out there, wherever you're watching from across the country or the world, in the case of you Girdwoods and Kalen Crosby. We're just getting started, friends. Coming up next, after this, it's the highly anticipated men's game. It's going to be a dandy. The number one Capers coming in against the number two Tigers, a team that the Tigers really struggled with last year. Thank you, Mr. Jim Walker. I should have mentioned the your local source for basketball information and stats, Nova Scotia Basketball. Basketball.novascotia.ca/Halifax. .ca/Halifax. That is Jim Walker's outstanding local site for all basketball information. Make sure you favorite that on your browser. So your stats, as mentioned, the big story is Trish McNeil. 10 points in the half for Trish McNeil for the Tigers. 3 for 5 from the three-point line. Courtney Thompson kicking in with 8 points. And two scorers here for the Capers. Kerry Everett returning to action with 11 points. And Nicole Works with 11 points as well. So some balanced scoring with both teams. But so far, the Capers shooting over 50%. Tigers are going to have to start maybe knocking down some shots here.
Yep. And once again, they've obviously been doing all right defensively. If no one's 25 points or something outrageous so far, but You know, they definitely have to keep up the consistency and keep up defensively in the second half because, you know, Carrie gets warmed up and she's going to hit all her sort of in the key jumpers and she's going to be driving a lot. So,
well,
sorry, just have to keep an eye on her and keep playing their game.
You might be shaking your heads if you're looking at stats. The Tigers, of course, actually are winning the turnover battle. The Capers have 14 turnovers, and the Tigers have 13. Looks like right now the Tigers are doing a pretty good at handling the press, but they're also getting helped out by the refs.
Yeah.
The refs are calling those fouls in that full court pressure, which a lot of times is what it comes down to when you play the Capers, whether or not the refs see contact.
Yep. Yeah, definitely can have a huge, Marcel already said the reffing has a huge impact when there's physical games and they sort of determine what kind of physicality is going to be allowed in the game. And it's sort of, you know, Capers are going to do better probably if the game is more physical. They've got some bigger people on their team, so that's going to play to their advantage. And so far it hasn't been an overly physical game.
Well, Thompson out there with Brooke Sullivan, Anavon Maltzen, Trish McNeil, and Garatowski, your starting five here for the Tigers as that high-low play. But again, that's the second 3-second call now on Garatowski.
To her credit, Garatowski's been doing a great job of getting open on some really big defenders. So she's really holding her own in the key.
There is Kernan out there with Everett. Haywood, Nicole Works, and McCarron. You're starting five for the Capers. Haywood was a load in that first half. And right away, Kernan gets back to work for the Capers. But Haywood, really a defensive problem for the Tigers right now.
Yep. And again, you want to have your taller players being in the lane, being aggressive, and just making it look scary as heck to drive. And she was doing a great job, doing that.
And now we are really into dangerous territory for the Tigers in the start of the third quarter. Now a 9-point lead for the Capers, so it really is time for the Tigers to lock things down here.
Yeah, and all it takes is a little bit of energy and scoring 2 points and a couple, you know, shutting down the Capers a couple times, and they can easily turn it around. So just have to bring it out this in the second half.
Well, this works down there to McCarron. Reverses through to Carrie Everett. She'll drive the lane, does that so well, and then finds Haywood on the other side, and that is something the Capers also do. They drive to one side and kick back to the other so well.
You know, and again, Haywood did a good job of having space. And was right there to get the easy bucket.
And sure enough, another turnover here. And there's the Fabian McKenzie that we know so well. He was seated there in the first half, but he is now up and roaming the sidelines here.
It's good of him. He's active and animated as always. So it's always, the coaches are always part of the entertainment of CIS basketball. So it's all part of the game.
So now 11 points, the lead for the Capers. They are starting to get some big time separation here in the opening stages of the third quarter. McCarron down there to Haywood, going to work on Brooks Sullivan, up and under, and too heavy. And rebounded, and it looks like a foul on the floor here on Brooks Sullivan.
Looked like Haywood had hit her head when she went down there, so she seems like she's all right. That did not look enjoyable for her. That's a long way down. So hopefully she's all right. She looks like she's going to stay on the floor there.
Lost in all this is Courtney Thompson's third foul. So three fouls now on Courtney. Fleet through the lane is Kernan. Comes up heavy on that little floater, but confusion with Thompson and Sullivan on the rebound. And ball back to the Capers.
Again, Thompson's been doing a good job on number 8, Kiernan. And, you know, part of that is you're going to be getting some fouls trying to keep her under wraps there. But her teammates have to support her there on defense.
Great play there by Carrie Everett. 13 points now for Carrie Everett. And right away, Anna Stamberger's going to call a timeout and try to put an end to this bleeding. But that baseline inbounds play, Carrie Everett.
That's the University Department of Athletics and Recreational Services.
Easy times now for the Capers. And a 13-point lead. And
Adidas Canada.
And again, Cape Breton is great at doing that. You sort of blink and they turn around and they've got a lead on you and you wonder how it happened. But they're, again, sort of, they're doing well and all the good teams in the league, they're ahead of the game because they're just consistently bring a good level of play. And again, at the CIS with women's basketball, I find it's the teams that are consistent and that just do the little things in day in and day out that end up you know, going to finals and doing well consistently. So, you know, Dalhousie has the capability to do that. And again, they just have to do it more often and extend the time where they're playing consistently, passing, trying to decrease their turnovers. You know, and you said started first half, Cape Breton actually had more turnovers, but I don't think Dal can feel too great about that because they still had 13 and many of them were unforced. So, you know, if you're the underdog coming into it, you have to be able to control all your parts of the game, and that includes unforced turnovers and, you know, things like that.
From my account here, from what I can gather, the Capers are now on a 19-2 run, dating back to the middle stages of the second quarter. So a 19-2 run here for the Capers, and they've stretched to a 13-point lead.
Yeah.
Working it around here up top with Brittany Sullivan. Trish McNeil trying to get an angle with Garatowski, but cut off by Haywood. And now Von Malsen up top, 6 seconds on the shot clock, drives through the lane, and she'll get a much-needed foul here on McCarron.
And that was a good, strong drive. She was fairly far away from the basket. It didn't look like that was going in, but just, you know, the reward for driving hard to the hoop is that you'll get the foul call sometimes. So, again, you want to see young players getting in there and not afraid to sort of mix it up and take a hard drive to the hoop.
Shooting two for the Tigers, number four. So one here so far for Von Malsen, and this would be a huge 2 points right now for the Tigers, desperate for a basket, as the Capers have really put on a show of force. And two for Anna Von Malsen, and now 11 points the deficit.
The Tigers need to use this and turn it around now. They're, with a team like Cape Breton, they're not going to be able to wait any longer and then pull it out in the fourth quarter. They're going to have to play with a lot of energy right now.
There's that 3-2 zone with Von Malsen up top. So slide down low on the baseline pass. Works right away here for the Tigers. Get a stop.
Another rebound by Von Malsen. She's been doing a really good job of blocking her girl out and being there on the defensive boards for Dal.
That is Von Malsen up top. She'll cut through. Gets that pass back from Sullivan. Haywood.
She's being consistently dynamic and doing the little things, and she's been a great supporter of the Tigers team this game.
This is Kiernan bringing it back down here for the Capers. Capers are in the orange uniforms going right to left. Baseline for Everett. Cut off by Sullivan. And that is off Brooke. 14 seconds on the shot clock for the Tigers.
And Brooke was doing a good job there containing Carrie and trying to push her, not letting her get right in close to the bucket when she was driving on the baseline there.
Inbounded by Kiernan. Way up top is Nicole Works from Sydney. Everett tries to work that baseline again. Cut off by Von Malsen. A nice job by Von Malsen and Thompson. And now here come the Tigers, led by Courtney. Takes it herself. Comes up short, does Courtney Thompson.
I'm happy to see that she took that to the hoop all the way, though. Oh, you always want to see people convert, but it's good that she was aggressive and that she went for it. She was in the best position, given that drive.
Tia Garatowski.
Confusion for the Capers. Haywood thought she had a player over there on that far side, but nobody but the speakers over there. And now possession to the Tigers. Kenesha will go sit down and get an earful from Baby McKenzie. Courtney Thompson. High post entry here with Garatowski. Little handoff play for Thompson. She'll drive the lane, runs into Everett, and that's going to be a block on Carrie Everett.
And another nice aggressive play by Thompson. She's doing a good job. She seems to be driving a lot just out of the gate for this quarter.
Six,
and,
Everett,
you know, they need that dynamicism, and they need that movement on offense. People need to be moving around. That Dal can't just sort of jump in and take a shot right off
no
the top.
Basket, Tigers
traveling. Called on Brooke
CBU
Sullivan.
Basketball.
There's a lot of little calls going against Dal right now, and it's hard to build up your momentum and sort of get on a real roll, but they're just going to have to really take pride in their defense and stop Cape Breton from extending their lead.
That is McCarron. Nicely done again by Thompson, and here she comes again with a head of steam. One-on-one on Nicole Works. Takes it herself. Comes up heavy. Garatowski with the rebound.
Again, you know, Thompson has missed the last two layups. She looks a little frustrated right now. You have to give her credit. She's taking the ball coast to coast, and she's going in aggressively. You can easily pull back and sort of set up. I think she's doing a great job, and, you know, she's really trying to light the fire here and get the team going. So they're gonna drop her.
So 24 seconds on the shot clock for Cape Breton. 6:35 left in the third quarter. And an 11-point lead for the team in orange in that four-way tie for first place in the opening stages of the second term down here for Toxopius. And we didn't see much of Stephanie, but makes good on that shot.
And she was just in so far. There was Dalhousie defenders right around her, but she was just so close and so tall that there's really no missing that bucket.
So Toxopius makes good, and now a 13-point lead for Cape Breton. Thompson way over there on the far side, gets a screen from Garatowski, pushes off, and now has a wide open shot. Comes up short. Garatowski again, a rebound. Left hand finish. Go over the line.
Great rebounding by Dal there. I mean, they're really going to have to get in there and get second chances because they haven't been shooting well. You said initially it was 10 for 30 from the field for them. So they're going to have to crash the boards and get those easy rebounds. I mean, they're not easy. You got to work hard to get the ball, but, you know, easier shots inside. Again, Courtney Thompson took a wide open shot when her defender sort of fell down. So great option when you're in that close and you've got two big rebounders that are on your team that, you know, are fighting for the boards. So she hasn't been hitting her last couple shots, but again, good aggressiveness, and she's trying to lead the charge here for the Dalhousie Tigers to get right back into the game.
Two foul shots for Brooke to go down at 11 points. Good news for the Tigers. They have one of their best players for the Capers in foul trouble, but stepping right up there is McCarron with a 15-foot baseline jump shot.
She made that look pretty easy. Again, there wasn't a defender too close, but sometimes that's what's going to happen when your team is in a zone.
And Stephanie Hiltz up here now for the Tigers, trailing by 13, puts a move on McClurkin. She's into the game for the Capers. Von Malten back into the defense on the floor. And traveling on Anna Von Malten.
Good hustle. She tried to correct her mistake right away by really getting on the floor Tigers quickly. She's had having great hustle this whole game. Basketball. So unfortunate little error there, but Dalhousie can get it back and get back into this.
5:20 left in the third quarter. This is Nicole Works up top for the Capers against that zone. 3-2 zone for the Tigers. Baseline for Carrie Everett. Again, Toxopius in traffic. This time comes up short. And now Stephanie Hiltz clears for the Tigers. McNeil and a full court foul here on Nicole Works, and that'll be her second of the game. And four team fouls now, I do believe, on the Capers.
Well, there's a little bit of time left. You're going to hope that Dal can get another foul called for them so that they can start getting into bonus there.
Kick ball here by Garatowski and back to the Tigers. So Tigers are getting stops, but they just can't convert here on the offensive end.
Yeah, and I mean, it happens to every team, but you can see that there's a bit of frustration out there. It's hard to keep motivated in a game when your efforts don't feel like they're being rewarded. But this is when good teams sort of tough it out and try and change the dynamicism or the tempo themselves.
And the officials, again, have been generous with the Tigers. You know, they called a lot of these fouls on the Capers that they don't always get.
You know, and that's wonderful for this game, but again, when Dalhousie goes and plays CBU at home, one can assume that it's not going to be quite the same. You know, you're not going to get those easy sort of things, and they're going to have to be really tough in taking up the ball. So, you know, it's working to their advantage. This game in the long run, I'm not sure if the reffing is really going to be helping them get better so that they can be really tough and get the ball across half.
Well, 13 points back to the lead here for the Capers. Stephanie Hiltz knocks those two down, and Nicole Works has three fouls. So significant starters for the Capers now. Kernan and Works with three fouls each. That is the 3-2. Hiltz working over there on Kira Peterson. She's into the game for the Capers. McCarron, McClurkin, and Toxopius. Might have traveled there, but no call. And rebounded and cleared by Garatowski, and a jump ball. And that has Stamberger up in arms, but possession to the Tigers.
Yeah, and Toxopius had a hard shot there. I mean, she's a tall girl, but there's a lot of defenders around her, and she had a weird flick on her wrist when she took the shot. So those shots are surprisingly hard to make from the post.
Here comes that double by the Capers. They've got Hiltz trapped, and possession now to the Capers. So Hiltz got mad. You know, Hiltz thought she was just in a one-on-one there with McClurkin, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, comes Carrie Everett.
And like you said before, Bill, they sort of lull you into a bit of a false sense of security there, and then someone comes out of nowhere and puts more pressure on you than you're expecting. And Dalhousie hasn't been responding well to that.
There's that little baseline jump shot from McCarron. Nothing but the bottom for her. And now 15 points the lead for the Capers.
Yep. And Cape Breton's looking pretty relaxed now. They sort of seem to have knocked out the cobwebs more to more their kind of a game in the second half, and we just haven't seen quite the same transition for Dalhousie. They're just looking a little bit tentative. Shots aren't quite falling for them right now. It's just, and that's just making the difference. It's not a huge, huge shift. It's just little things again.
I think we had traveling on that play on Bon Molson from the rip from the high post. So ball to the Capers at 3:51 left in your third quarter. And the Capers can really build it up here
Tigers
now.
Call for 3 seconds in the key.
3 seconds in the key again for the Tigers. So that's their third 3 second call of the game. Comes up heavy on that shot. And a rebounding foul on the Tigers. On the Capers, sorry, nope. And the Tigers will be shooting.
Again, for the Tigers as a team, we're not entirely sure what's the sort of main issue. There's a lot of little things contributing to them not really being able to get the flow of their game that they'd like to get back to. And, you know, Tigers have taken the time to sort of have a pep talk with themselves. And there's not a whole lot you can do as a coach right now. You can't get on the floor and play. So the girls have to sort of motivate themselves, calm themselves down, and work towards getting back into the groove, as a unit and get back into this.
So two shots for Brooke, makes the first, makes the second, 6 points on the match now for Brooke Sullivan, and a 13-point lead for the Capers.
And again, just great to see little things like making both of your foul shots, mm-hmm. and those are the sort of things that they have to focus on and just take every little victory like that and work back into it.
Big pressure by Hiltz, but a foul on Stephanie, and she's going to have to settle down here. It's not, and Dave McGrattan will have words for her on the floor there, but a foul on Stephanie Hiltz.
Again, you want to see hustle and you want to see, Dalhousie exerting pressure back, a defensive pressure on the Capers, but it's got to be in the right way, and it's got to be ball pressure rather than that kind of pressure.
McClurkin up top. Tigers stay in that zone. That's Peterson here on the wing, baseline with Everett. Can't reverse this through to McClurkin, a wide open look for McCarron. And now the Capers really starting to look comfortable, as you said, in that zone.
And again, Dalhousie had good energy on that last possession. They were they're in the offensive players' faces, and they're running around. But Carrie Everett just took her experience, and she just made that shot.
And one for Anna von Molson. So finally, a response here from the Tigers, and now the Tigers really need a 3-point play here.
Yep.
This to 12 points. 13 points is the lead for the Capers.
CBU foul number 9, Kayla McCarron.
And Molson has been sort of Van Molson has been sort of the silent presence in this game. Again, just doing a lot of good things defensively, and she's been really key in getting some rebounds and doing sort of the little things in this game. So she's stepping up, and she's being consistent. And again, to see someone take that next step and really make a dynamic play like that is what Dallas is going to have to do right now and continuously for the next quarter. To try and stay in this game at all.
Well, as we mentioned earlier, the Capers on a bit of a run here. 29-12, by my account, is the run that the Capers are on. The Tigers led 27-23 at one point, and now 52-39 is the lead for the Capers. So the Tigers, they're starting to work towards it. If they could just hang on here and maybe get it down to single digits by the end of the quarter, they've got three significant Capers with foul trouble now. So if the Tigers can buckle down here, they can set themselves up for a comeback in the fourth quarter.
And again, I think if they play smart, they're in a good position to do that. They've got a lot of dynamic players who are great. Have been getting the foul calls when they do drive. So if you get Von Meltzen and McNeil and Thompson all driving offensively, then you're gonna put some good players on Cape Breton in serious foul trouble and make them have to play a more tentative game. That's obviously not that's not their go-to. So, but again, you see a real hesitancy in players to start driving in the fourth quarter closer to the end of the game because you just kind of want to take a jump shot and be a little bit lazier on offense, and that's a tendency. So we'll see if Dallas sort of pulls through in there, push through the fatigue at all to sort of keep driving and keep being aggressive on offense.
Well, this is Von Molson trying to finish off the 3-point play. She does, and now 7 points for Anna Von Molson. And again, with a bunch of rebounds too. We don't have the numbers there, but she may be on her way to a double-double here for Anna. And up top again in that zone. Way over there. That is Lucy Ann Leahy into the game for the Capers. Katie McCarrigal into the game for the Capers as well. So some substitutions here for the Cape. and barely had that, or nearly had that.
That's CBU basketball
seven. And it's great to see Dalhousie putting pressure on Cape Breton and getting in the lanes and doing that. They haven't been contesting the ball like that all game, so they're going to need to keep bringing that energy.
5 seconds on the shot clock for Cape Breton. A little floater by Leahy. Comes up heavy and tucks a Pius and Thompson and a jump ball. And it is possession arrow to the Tigers.
Side possession, jump ball.
You know, a lot of times possession the refs call that jump ball so quickly. Ball. It looked like Courtney Thompson was going to come away with that. But now the Tigers do get possession, but they lose it for the next time. So.
Yeah, unfortunately.
And there's a turnover. McClurkin takes it herself for two. And now trouble for the Tigers.
Tanira McClurkin.
Again, that, you know, Cape Breton's been doing a great job of just getting those quick little turnovers and, you know, getting in people's space and getting the ball. So Dal has to really support each other down the floor and can't take it for granted.
Thompson had a wide open lane, but one dribble too many and got cut off by Carey Everett.
Tigers ball, 10 on the shot clock.
And now 10 seconds on the shot clock for the Tigers. 2:16 left in the third. Kick out here for Brooke Sullivan. Up fake, Santox at Pius. Into the lane is Brooke. Comes up short, but she'll get a foul on the Capers.
Again, I'm not sure that play was doing too much. I guess it was designed to get Brooke in and driving, but there was two Cape Breton defenders right there at a certain meter. So, and you want to see your wings moving around and adjusting, because if two people are on Brooke, someone's got to be open for the jumper.
Shooting two for your Tigers, number 10, Brooke Sullivan.
So two shots for Brooke Sullivan. And 57-40. Lead for the Capers. It must have, you know what? They fixed it earlier. I was going to say it's that three they missed earlier, but I thought it was 54 to 40, but all of a sudden there's three up there on the board for Cape Breton. So 57-41, the lead for the Capers. And one of two for Sullivan. So 16 points is the margin here.
Left in the third
down
quarter.
There for Everett on the baseline. Gets it off, but tipped away by Von Maltzen.
That was a great athletic play by Von Maltzen there.
And a foul here, so the Tigers can chip away at this from the foul line. Coop, I don't know where those 3 points came from. I saw 54-40, and all of a sudden I looked up, it was 57-40.
Maybe you're thinking of the band.
Number 10,
yeah,
the
Garicle, third. Ah, that outstanding foul. Band.
Two for Tigers, number five,
from the West Coast.
Big hair and CanCon. Yep. You can't beat it.
And the Tigers kind of shooting themselves in the foot here with these missed foul shots.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the percentage they are from the foul line right now, but it's every game you want to see your team making a high percentage from the foul line.
Well, Courtney Thompson now with about 11 points here on this game and a 15-point deficit. For the Tigers, 1:45 left in the third, traveling, so the Tigers can start building.
Nice. Good pressure good defensive pressure on the ball from Thompson there. Again, it's great to see Dal giving it back to Cape Breton in the way that Cape Breton's been putting the pressure on them. So it's great to remember that they're susceptible to making all the same mistakes that the Tigers are making if given the sort of concerted effort on the pressure.
A wide open lane for Trish McNeil. She has no problem finishing it now, Trish. Back on the scoreboard here. 13 points on the game now for Trish McNeil. And a turnover. So the Tigers with a late flurry. Von Maltzen takes it herself, but comes up heavy. And another missed chance for the Tigers.
Yeah. And they're still on a roll, though. They're still picking it up. So we're going to have to let that one slide. But, again, that's a little bit experience just making those. Some teams you just know they're going to make their wide open layups like that. And Tigers showing a little bit of lack of experience there, but great effort and energy to turn the ball around.
Well, here's another turnover. Now McNeil trying to drive that baseline again, gets cut off. Back up to Brooke Sullivan. 15 seconds on the shot clock. Tigers really given a chance here to get back into this. Thompson, and it is a charge on Thompson. Toxopius stepped in and took that one for the Capers.
Well, that was a great defensive play by Toxopius there. Thompson's quick. It's hard to have your feet planted and be in the right place because she's fairly good at getting around people. So good defensive play by the Capers there.
And that one hurts for the Tigers as well. That's Courtney Thompson's fourth personal foul. So she will have to sit. And Brittany Sullivan back into the game for the Tigers. So the Tigers will lose some energy and scoring there with Courtney Thompson. And turnover. Great job by Stephanie Hiltz to create that turnover.
Nice little hustle there. She knew which way the ball was going. She was pointing.
Look at that, Coop. Back to 54-44. So I don't know what happened there, but we are back to a 54-point game for the Capers.
It just made the Tiger run look a little bit bigger than it was, I guess. So 10-point difference.
So if you're keeping score at home, it is 54-44 right now. And the Tigers really, you know, they could be within six now had they taken advantage of these opportunities. But it's biting away here on the Tigers.
Again, you can always say that in a basketball game, and they just need to be able to bear down, finish off the quarter strong, and then play a relaxed, and keep to their game in the fourth quarter.
Well, the shot clock basically turned off here. There's 24.1 on the game clock and 24-second shot clock for the Tigers. So a chance for the Tigers to play this out, but turned over. McNeil aggressive on the drive and taken away by the Capers with McCarrigle. Yeah. And now the Capers can play it out. 12 seconds left in the quarter. 10-point lead for Cape Breton. There's Everett on the baseline. Gets the foul on Von Molson. And now the Capers can get back up to a comfortable double-digit lead.
Again, Von Molson looking pretty frustrated on that call. She's really hustling. She's really making the efforts there. Things are not really kind of falling into place for the Tigers this game, although they've gotten on a few good rolls and they've had some good effort. They're just going to have to hope that things are starting going their way and they can kind of click into gears in the fourth quarter.
So Everett makes her first, and now to get to a 12-point lead for Everett it is. So 12 points for the Capers here. 5 seconds left in the third quarter. This is Stephanie Hiltz in trouble there with McClurkin. Gets it to McNeil. She has a chance. She's got to get it off. And she does not. One dribble. Too many for Trish McNeil.
Too bad it looked like it was in for me. Good aggressive attempt for the Tigers to get back in and get another quick 2 points to keep it within 10 points. But just a 12-point difference at the moment for the Cape Breton Capers.
Well, we started the quarter with a 36-27 lead for the Capers, and we're now at 56-44, so 20-17. Capers outscored the Tigers in that quarter, but could have been a little worse for the Tigers. But again, they got to be pretty happy. Oh, sorry, Jimmy. They got to be pretty happy. I nearly put Jim Walker on his waist here.
It's full contact on the bleachers here as well, folks.
Could have been again a lot worse. Tigers within shooting range here of the Capers, but as you say, they got to just keep working. But man, the Tigers really did miss some chances there. The missed layup by Von Molson, some missed foul shots. But scrappy are these youthful Tigers today at home.
Yeah. The other way to look at it too is the fact that I don't know that Cape Breton, apart from the effective trapping that they've been doing, their half-court trap, apart from that, they haven't really been doing anything defensively that's totally messing the Tigers up. In the half-court, when they're running their own plays well, the Tigers can get the shots they want, and they can, get the ball into the post, and they can do all sorts of things quite effectively. So that's a pretty strong testament to how effectively they're working in their own half court. It's just getting the ball over there and not making, not shooting themselves in the foot, making good passes, and all those little things that are hurting them this game, it seems.
And of course, as mentioned a little bit earlier or a few minutes ago, there are several significant Capers in foul trouble here. Kernan, the leading scorer, she has three fouls. McCarron, a starter, has three fouls. And Nicole Works, the starting point guard, has three fouls as well. So the Tigers have done a good job of getting the Capers in some foul trouble. So some stops and some aggressive offensive play, they can really get back into this. I guess the one missing piece here for the Tigers maybe has been Tia Garatowski. She hasn't quite been herself that she was, we saw towards the end of the first term. So maybe Tia Garatowski can hopefully maybe get it going here for the Tigers.
Yeah, and she's in a bit of a tough position here because it's not a terribly tall Tigers team. That was alliteration for everyone back home. But they're not so tall. So her height is missed if she's having a little bit of an off game at all. But she's had some moments of good rebounding and whatnot in this game as well.
Well, there is Kernan with her first shot of the fourth quarter. Back in here now for the Capers. 2-on-1 of the Tigers. McNeil comes up short. Tough layup there with Kernan in traffic.
again, Dalhousie got the boards there, and if they can start getting a few more offensive boards and get some second chances and start driving and get the Capers into foul trouble, they can sort of stay in this game in the last quarter here.
Cleared by the Capers. Kernan up top again. Tigers staying in that 3-2 zone. Down there for Everett, right in the middle, and Carey's going to travel down there, and, you know, I guess you can't say the fifth-year senior has struggled. She scored 15 points, but she hasn't quite seemed her normal fluent self, Carey Everett. Yeah.
Fair enough if you've, you haven't been playing for the first part of the season, but, you know, again, it's someone that you expect by the time playoffs roll around will be a force to be reckoned with, and will be definitely something that Dalhousie has to have a specific game plan to deal with.
The Tigers now really working that baseline drive with McNeil, but she's come up short twice. And now the Tigers are getting stops, and that's been the big thing about this run, Coop. Yep. The Tigers have been getting stops as well.
Yep. They've been doing pretty well, particularly in their zone. They've been having a lot of success.
Well, Anna Von Maltzen starting to heat up now. 9 points for Von Maltzen and a 10-point lead for the Capers. So really time to get at it here for the Tigers. Collapsing there on Everett. But look at the fifth-year senior. As soon as I said that she hasn't looked herself.
She heard you, Bill.
Yeah,
she retaliated.
Some dexterity there by Carey Everett.
Yeah, and some fancy footwork at the other end from Von Maltzen there. Again, she's been getting lots of boards, and we saw a great, great move in the key from her.
Back this way it is. Brooke Sullivan charging towards the basket. And I got a foul. Oh, it's going to be charge on Brooke Sullivan. So the officials got together there. And they're going to call a charge on Brooke.
Tough for Brooke. I think the Tigers need to take that. It's better to get charging fouls at this point for them because they are just going to have to be plowing and driving and keeping aggressive in order to do well in this game. So take a charge. That's fine. But just keep driving to the hoop at all costs.
Two fouls now on Brooke Sullivan, and here's a wide-open look for Kernan. Rims out for Kernan. Rebounded by the Capers. And a jump ball to the Tigers. And, you know, I was looking at the stats earlier. It's like a team like the Tigers, they play zone so much. But I was looking at the rebounding numbers, and the Tigers actually out-rebound their opponents for the most part. So it's fortuitous for a team that plays a lot of zone to actually be out-rebounding their opponents.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, no, it definitely can be. You can be in a weird position. It can be hard to find your girl when you're in a zone, and then you realize the shot goes up.
Von Maltzen going through the lane. Hiltz comes up short on that three-point shot. And we got a push on the Tigers. So two team fouls here early on the Tigers.
Again, that's, you know, that's unfortunate foul. You don't want those fouls sort of disrupting the flow of your game. But Tigers are going to have to be aggressive. And those are the kind of fouls that you can at least deal with. Much better to be getting a foul from an aggressive drive to the hoop or aggressively trying to get a rebound versus a ticky-tacky foul in transition, you know, where there's no reason. So at least those are kind of the right kind of fouls that you want people to be making out of aggression and out of really trying to get the ball.
Well, Coop, there is our fifth foul on Courtney Thompson. So, Pam and David in beautiful St. John, your daughter, played well tonight, but
yep.
Just got into some foul troubles, which happens with those quick Cape Breton guards.
Yep, for sure.
But she will watch this one from the sidelines.
Well, that's going to be hard for her because she has been playing well this game, and you definitely, you know, you want this team to be able to get as much sort of time with their key players working together under pressure situations, trying to execute, you know, so... Unfortunate that Thompson will be sitting out for the rest of it, but we'll see who steps up, and there's been some other Tigers that have been playing great this game as well.
Well, Tia Karatowski back in here now for the Tigers. So a little size for Courtney Thompson. Tigers still in that zone, trailing by 12. This is Kernan. Kernan matched up there with McNeil. Von Maltzen out on that on work. She's back into the game playing with three fouls. A nice wide-open look for Kernan. Comes up front rim and ripped away by Stephanie Hiltz.
Which you wouldn't think she was the key rebounder for the Tigers, but she's been getting a few rebounds for them.
Baseline drive, baseline drift here for the Tigers, but no luck from Von Maltzen. Sticking with it, though, is Anna. And now Anna Von Maltzen, the storyline of this half. She's played very well.
Yeah, again, she's really consistent for the Tigers, which they've got to appreciate. She's been all over the place, and she's really hustling in the middle of their 3-2 zone, trying to keep it all under wraps.
And there's Carey Everett. A lot of swagger right there with Everett. She's won conference championships and the fifth-year senior now with 19 points to lead the Capers.
You know, again, she wasn't as much of a factor in the first half, but Dalhousie has to acknowledge that her experience is, she's warmed up, her experience is huge, and they're going to have to make a special effort to stop her, particularly in the last quarter.
And we got trouble for the Tigers. This looks like an offensive foul on Von Molson.
Offensive foul charged Tigers number four. Anna
moved her hips there on that screen.
Foul, team foul number three.
And that'll be three personals now on Anna Von Molson. And the third team foul on Anna Stenberger is going to get it. Three fouls on Anna.
Tigers call timeout.
Always tough on that call. You know, you think you held your ground, but sometimes your body just slips out on you. And
yeah. Well, you always think you held your ground. Right. That's generally how it works. Like, as far as when I played, I'm pretty sure I never moved my feet on anything, and the refs were just wrong every time in my head. But, it's been hard for Dalhousie to just get their momentum going. There's always been a little foul or a weird turnover consistently, and they haven't really got a satisfying run to try and get back at the Capers' lead in a hugely significant way. So... it's getting down to the wire. It's going to be tough for them to battle back. It's still possible, obviously, but it's getting tougher and tougher as the time ticks down.
TigersWebcast@gmail.com is your email. TigersWebcast@gmail.com. Set your scoreboard for you. 60-48 for the Capers. 6:36 left in the game. And three team fouls for the Tigers and none for the Capers here. And coming up next, oh, baby. It's number one, Cape Breton, the champs, coming in here to play the number two Dalhousie Tigers in the men's game. It will be a doozy. So make sure you come back 20 minutes after this one finishes for that outstanding matchup.
It should be a pretty packed house for that. The bleachers are already starting to fill up quite a lot.
Yeah,
so.
The early birds are starting to arrive, and we expect a full house here. The Plex, one of the, maybe the headline matchup in AUS sport this weekend, the Tigers and the Capers.
Yeah.
Tigers back in that zone, and now this is a wide-open look for Kernan. Comes up short. Hustling here for the rebound is Von Molson, but that was Everett that got there first. 21 seconds on the shot clock now for the Capers.
Dell's doing a good job of moving their feet and getting and trying to contest the shots. Cape Breton's been moving the ball around quite a lot because they're under no pressure to get a quick shot off.
Skip pass way over here, and a three-point shot from McCarrigal. So the Halifax product makes good on a three. And now the Capers, some big-time separation here, 15 points.
Yep. And they're looking calm while they're doing it. They're taking their time, finding the open person, and really, really being relaxed out there.
No luck on that duck in for the Tigers. And 63-48. The lead for the Capers again, and with the basketball here. So Tigers starting to get some hands on hips out there for the Tigers, and maybe start to slip away here.
Again, Dalhousie doesn't, I don't know what their stance is on getting in and sort of initiating more full court pressure. It seems like they might have to resort to a different tactic at this point, because Cape Breton is passing the ball around pretty calmly. And scoring, apparently.
Yeah, that is Kernan. She's starting to get her swagger on now. And a two-point shot for Kernan. She is the Capers' leading scorer.
It's hard once they get in the roof like this to sort of knock them out of it again. So I'm not sure what Dalhousie can throw at them to get them out of their routine.
Von Molson, that's going to be a continuation for Anna Von Molson. And now close to maybe 14 points here now for Anna.
Again, working hard while she's doing it, too. She's not skimping and saving her energy just for offense. She's been working hard in the middle of the zone, running around and, just been a consistent force for the Tigers throughout the whole game.
She's very similar to Carrie Everett of the Cape in that she's a tough matchup. She's a little too big for guards, a little too small for big post players. So very hard to match up with Anna Von Molson.
Yeah, and pretty dynamic in terms of when she's got 2 feet in the key, she's able to do a dipsy-doo and pull off a post move with the athleticism of a guard. And then also, like you said, taller on the wing. So for sure, those kind of guards can provide some real problems and challenges defensively for teams.
Nearly a turnover for Brittany Sullivan. She's back out there. Von Molson will go sit and get a breather. She looked tired. 15 points to lead for Cape Breton. A little foul line jump shot for Kernan. Comes up well short and rebounded off of Garatowski. And a fresh shot clock now for the Capers. Tigers need some stops in a hurry.
Yeah, again, I don't know what they're... It seems like it's going to be time for a full court press or for something different for them in order to just put more pressure on CBU because they're looking far too comfortable at this point, sort of passing the ball around the perimeter without too much. You can't be out on the perimeter all the time if you're in the zone, right?
Well, 4:52 left in your in the game, and it's a 15-point lead for the Capers. This is Kernan up top, matched with Hiltz. Gets into the lane, kicks. Half foul by Stephanie Hiltz.
Great hustle.
That was Haywood. Yep.
Great hustle. She's, you know, she got out there, and that's the right call for her in that case. You can't have them just getting another two easy buckets.
You know, seeing the Capers over the last 10 years, the people come and go, but the things they do so well seems to be so consistent. You know, the full court pressure, ability to drive the basket, kick to open post players off of the help. Fabian McKenzie really done a pretty incredible job of keeping this team steady over a long period of time now.
Yep, for sure. And it's definitely the personnel you have to work with, but coaching, you know, play such a huge factor in any team's success.
And look at Denisha Haywood from Baltimore. She's been a force for the Capers defensively and offensively. A tough matchup for these Tigers. Garatowski, she has really struggled. Gets that one heavy and big rebound for Tia and gets the foul here on Haywood.
Nice aggression there. Tia sort of showing a little bit of nervousness there. She was kind of hippy-hopping as she got the ball for that jumper
CB
there.
Denisha Haywood.
You know, it hasn't been the calmest game for her. So hopefully she'll get the jitters out this game and can come in and refocus for the next game and for the last 5 minutes of this one as well.
Well, you talk about a kid that's really grown up in a hurry. She struggled early in the season with foul trouble. She came from the Alberta Conference, the college conference, so she's making that jump to the next level. She's leading the Tigers at points. So she's done a really good job of growing with each game.
Yep.
But tonight she definitely, right from the start, she looked really jumpy, like you just said, you know.
It can be easy when you're starting to have some successes to sort of knock the expectations up way high for yourself and put yourself under pressure, and who knows what the factors are for her. But, you know, she is a good contributor for Dal, and I'm sure she'll be back at it next game.
Well, Haywood keeps up over the top of Brittany Sullivan, and now a big-time lead here. Maybe the biggest lead of the game for the Capers, 69-52 for Cape Breton. The Tigers did lead 27-23 at one point, but since then it has been the majority of the Capers. Brooke Sullivan trying to go to work on Haywood, gets cut off. A wide-open three for Brittany, comes up heavy.
Great rebound there by Brooke. Again, Dal needs all the second chances they can get to close the gap.
17 points is the lead. Brooke Sullivan up fake on Haywood, drives baseline, gets cut off. Has Von Molson down there. 10 seconds on the shot clock and just no room to move. But off of Kira Peterson.
I mean, Haywood was putting great ball pressure on. I mean, when you've got long arms and you're putting on ball pressure, it makes it extremely hard for the other person to make a pass anywhere.
There's a three for Brooke. Comes up heavy. And rebounded by Haywood. And now the Capers starting to feel it. 3:35 left in the fourth quarter, and close to putting this one away. That is McClurkin. Peterson, Everett on the baseline. She has been outstanding, making her first start of the year after the injury. And Nicole works from Sydney, comes up short, and look who it is, Haywood.
Yeah.
Comes up heavy, and there's Everett. 21 points now for Carrie Everett. And coaches across the AUS will be looking at that box score and saying, oh boy, Carrie Everett's back.
Yeah, for sure. Cape Breton again, just looking relaxed and not sort of playing in the flow mode. They're really somewhat like they were making a lot of turnovers in the first half, and you just don't see that at all now. They're totally comfortable. So Dell's gonna have to switch up the game plan for tomorrow's game.
Well, that was Stephanie Hiltz, 71-54 now for the Capers. McClurkin, Peterson, a wide open three, and she comes up heavy and rebounded by Brooke Sullivan. That's a great point, Coop. You know, you got to in a weekend set, you got to start building for the next day, and that's what the Tigers need to do now, get some momentum for tomorrow.
Yeah, for sure. And Dal's got home court advantage, and they started off strong against Cape Breton, and again, we've seen when Dalhousie plays their own game and they don't get intimidated by the half-court trap and they support each other, they're perfectly able to drive and to execute against this team. And that's really reassuring. I mean, Trish McNeil can go in and drive. Van Maltzen, Thompson can go and drive any day. They can get their jumpers if they play smart. So they can play with anyone in the conference. And how long they extend those moments of sort of brilliance, it's all up to them, really.
Well, 71-56 now the lead for the Capers. 2.5 left. And this is Nicole Works. We'll do it again tomorrow, 2 o'clock, from the Dalplex. Capers and Tigers, so make sure you join us then, friends, on SSN Canada. The second game of this two-game set. Down there for Haywood, working on Sullivan. Over the top of Sullivan, and no problem for Denisha. From Baltimore, Maryland. Again, one of those Baltimore players from Cape Breton. They've had that pipeline now for about 10 years.
It seems to be a pretty lucrative pipeline. Like Haywood's been playing wonderfully for Cape Breton today.
Trish McNeil with the and one, and she's been working that drive, and gets one to go here in traffic.
Again, defensively, it's tough for Brooke Sullivan to match up against Haywood, the 4-inch difference. She's got to make sure she keeps pushing her so she's farther away from the basket to really be as effective.
Crafty play by Von Malton sets up McNeil, and she follows her own shot. So Von Malton and McNeil giving us a glimpse of the future here, maybe. Of course, this is a Tigers team that is kind of building towards the future right now, and those two players will be a huge part of it. That is Everett for Peterson. Peterson gets into the lane and travels. Kira Peterson.
Again, if we see if Dallas sort of sticks to their game, they're able to pull this off. I mean, Cape Breton is one of the toughest teams in the league, so there's so much that's within their control, and it's just a matter of being able to execute that time in and time out and game in and game out.
Stephanie Hiltz, 1:27 left in our fourth quarter, and 73-60. For Cape Breton, there's McNeil, kicked out for Stephanie. She's going to fire that. Comes up short. Rebounded by the hustling McNeil. Played very well tonight. Drives that baseline again and again. And one for McNeil.
That is such a hard angle to do a little sort of running layup like that. So a great, great bucket there by McNeil.
Well, we've seen some, in the first half it was McNeil, and then it was Von Malton for a while, and now it's McNeil again. So.
And again, Dalhousie, to be really effective, they're going to kind of need two people to step up at the same time and really carry them through to play well against good teams like Cape Breton.
Well, Hiltz over there putting pressure on that entry, but McClurkin has it. And down here for Haywood, going to work again on Sullivan. This time, Brooks hold her own, and actually a 10-point lead now with 1 minute left. So the Tigers with a chance, but that just might about do it. That turnover with Works, and now in transition are the Capers. McClurkin takes it herself for two, and now a 12-point lead for Cape Breton.
Again, you got to appreciate Dal fighting back in the last minutes, trying to keep it going.
Are you kidding me? Another and one for Trish McNeil. Three now in the last 2 minutes. And the Tigers can close with 9 points here.
CBU foul
shot. And maybe McKenzie has just had about enough of that. He's going to call a timeout. And
I'm sure he's got words.
Yeah.
Again, if Dal is able to keep the clock stopped and get some foul shots in and keep driving, you can sort of, it's definitely possible to get back in. Crazy things happen in basketball in the last minute of the game. So
the storyline here, the closing minutes, aside from the Capers kind of getting some separation and putting this one away slowly but surely, has been Trish McNeil, maybe up to about 20 points now for the youngster, second-year player from Halifax. And, a Tigers team that, working towards the future. Next year, they got Von Malton and McNeil in their second year or third year. Courtney Thompson will be in her second year. They've got Keisha Brown, the highly Ballyhoo transfer from Acadia. Yep. She'll be ready to go. So good times on the horizon here, maybe, for this Tigers team. But not giving up on this year as well. But,
Again, they have to stay focused, and there's a lot they can do. They've got some really talented players now. So, and, I think we can see they could have capitalized more on this game now, not looking at the future at all. So, they definitely could have brought a little more energy and stepped it up a little more, although it's a very tough team.
Ooh, that was a tough screen on Brittany Sullivan. Could have been offensive, but no call coming. And now we got a foul on Stephanie Hiltz, and that is the Tigers' fifth team foul, so shots for the Capers.
Tigers foul number 24, Stephanie Hiltz. Fourth personal foul, team foul number five.
Four personals on Stephanie.
Shooting two for CBU.
And this is McClurkin with two shots for the Capers. Hopping in for McClurkin.
Again, Dalhousie's pretty close to the end of the game here. It would have been interesting to see what it would have been, the score would have been like with Courtney Thompson still in the mix, and she was out for the whole fourth quarter due to fouls trouble. So,
Haywood just over the top of Brooke Sullivan. Misses that left-handed putback and then gets the foul on Von Malton. So hard-working big body down there, Haywood.
Yeah. Just she's playing, and she's only in her second year of eligibility. She's just playing pretty unhurried, you know, and very pretty good basketball, particularly in the second half. I don't know that she was quite as much of a factor in the first half, but just really stepped up in the second half and has been making good decisions and making all the easy layups and just doing what you need to do in the post.
Well, friends, again, remember,
2 o'clock tomorrow, Atlantic time, for the game 2 of this weekend set between the Capers and the Tigers. But coming up next, the men's game with the Capers and the Tigers. It's going to be a good one. So after our buzzer here comes back, come back and join us in about 20
Tigers
minutes.
For a late violation.
If you're new to SSN Canada, all you have to do is, after this game ends, we'll sign off and then just go back to the front page and click on the link for the men's game. It'll be right there on the right-hand side of the screen. 1 of 2 for Haywood, and now 77-66 for the Capers. 25 seconds left in this one. And Hill's going to call play here for the Tigers. Daratowski. Trish McNeil rips through, kicks out for Von Molson, a little up fake, drives baseline, and comes up well short on that shot, and that'll take it to the end here. 7 seconds left. And a nice win for the Capers.
Yep.
They will now, based on what's, I'm not sure what's happened in Newfoundland, but whoever won between UNB and Munn will have 16 points. And the X-Men now, or the Capers now have 16 points. And the Caper, or the X-Men, and whoever lost that UNB-Munn game has 14 points. Anyways, it'll all come out in the wash. but in this game here, Tigers team that very comfortable early on, played really well. The Capers kind of went on that little run, but the Tigers team that battled back showed a lot of grit.
Yep.
As we mentioned, showed a lot of momentum. Building towards that game tomorrow.
Yeah, for sure. And again, I think for the Tigers, we saw a lot of individual momentum with different players standing out. Thompson, Von Molson, and at the end there with a flurry from Trish McNeil.
Yeah.
So, and then there's a lot of players that played solid consistency. Like, I think Brooke Sullivan did a good job defensively on some tough Kate Tall, Kate Brentner. So, again, they're close, They just wasn't quite clicking into place as a unit for the Tigers tonight.
26 points.
Well, Carrie Everett, what a return, the fifth-year senior. Missed the entire first term, but now back, and 26 points to lead the Capers. So the Capers welcoming back Carrie Everett with a big game. Trish McNeil, the player of the game for the Tigers. And, of course, Courtney Thompson, too, got into foul trouble there and fouled out with 8 minutes left. So had Courtney not gotten into foul trouble, it might have been a different game down the stretch. But Tia Garatowski kind of struggled. But, again, if you're Anna Sandberger with this youthful team, you got to be pretty happy.
Yep, for sure, pretty happy. And, in any given game, you're going to have a player who's fairly critical, who's going to not be 100% there, and that's just a factor of playing sports. So, good teams are able to compensate for that, and good players are able to pull themselves out of that partway through the game and try and turn it around. So it's definitely a learning. That was definitely a learning game for Dalhousie.
Well, Coop, we'll do it again tomorrow, 2 o'clock. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill.
Her
See
name is
then.
Emma Cooper. Outstanding stuff again from tonight. From Emma, she'll be back tomorrow for that 2 o'clock game. Stick around, friends, in 18 minutes. It will be the men, the Tigers and the Capers. You can see them on the floor right now. It's number 1 versus number 2 in the AUS Conference. So come back. It should be a good one. The final score here from the Dalplex in the women's game, the Capers 77, the Tigers 66. Have yourselves an outstanding evening. And remember, your email is tigerswebcasts@gmail.com. We'll see you in about 20 minutes.